AP Chemistry Unit 5 is always considered one of the toughest units covering chemical kinetics. It requires deep understanding of chemical reactions, rates, and strong mass skills. Hi there, my name is Jeremy Krug, and this is the place for all things AP Chemistry. You're about to see the 10 most important things you've got to know from Unit 5. If you're new here, welcome. Take a look around, check out my AP Chemistry playlists, that's where the action is, and make sure you subscribe. YouTube tells me that the vast majority of you haven't subscribed yet. So what are you waiting for? It's free, and it's an easy way to help out the channel. And if you're serious about getting that 5 on the AP exam, check out my ultimate review packet for AP Chemistry. It's got the full review videos for every unit, complete study guides, practice questions, and 2 full practice exams in the AP exam simulator. You can get a free sample today over at ultimatereviewpacket.com. Now, here are the 10 things you've got to know from Unit 5. Number 1, there are 4 main ways to change the rate of a reaction. Change the temperature, change the concentration of the reactants, change the particle size of the reactants, and add or remove a catalyst. Raising the temperature is a very effective way to make a reaction go faster, because when the temperature increases, molecules collide more often, and they collide with more force, because they're moving faster. That allows more of the collisions to be effective and produce a reaction. Raising the concentration of the reactants also works because when reactant molecules are closer to each other, they collide more often, leading to more effective collisions. When we decrease the particle size of the reactants, we increase the surface area of the reactants, which actually provides more spots or more active sites, as we say in chemistry, where a reaction can take place. It's also effective to add a catalyst. A catalyst is a substance that speeds up a chemical reaction without being used up in the process. And catalysts work by lowering the activation energy of a reaction by providing an alternate, lower energy pathway for the reaction. We'll take a look at that a bit later. Number 2. To determine the order of a reaction with respect to a reactant, determine how that reactant's concentration changes over different experimental trials. Then, see how that change affects the initial rate of reaction. In these problems, you'll see a chemical reaction followed by multiple trials in a table that looks something like this. And maybe the question asks us to determine the order of the reaction with respect to NO. We need to find 2 trials where NO is the only reactant that's changing concentration. In this case, that would be trials 1 and 2, since the hydrogen concentration is held constant. The NO concentration from trial 1 to trial 2 doubles, and the rate goes up by a factor of 4. Well, the power that makes this a true equality is second power, so this tells us that NO is second order. We can do the same thing for the other reactant, H2. This time, we have to find 2 trials where H2 is the only reactant that's changing, while NO stays constant. It looks like trials 1 and 3 will work for that. The H2 concentration is being doubled, while the initial rate is doubling as well. The power that makes this a correct equality is 1, so this is first order with respect to hydrogen. Number 3. The rate law of a reaction is written in the format rate equals K times A to the X times B to the Y, and so forth, where A and B are initial concentrations of reactants, X and Y are reaction orders, K is the rate constant, and rate is the initial rate of reaction. In the reaction we had before, we would write the rate law as rate equals K times the first reactant, which is NO, raised to the second power, since it was second order, times the concentration of H2 to the first power, since it was first order. We can use the rate law to calculate the rate constant, and all we have to do is take any of these trials and plug the data into the rate law. Let's use trial 1 just as an example. In trial 1, the rate is 1.6 times 10 to the negative 3rd molarity per second. We're trying to solve for the rate constant K. In trial 1, NO is 0.035 molar squared, since it's second order, and hydrogen's concentration is 0.012 molar. We do some multiplication and division, and we find that the rate constant is 1.1 times 10 to the second molarity to the negative 2 seconds to the negative 1. Number 4. Reaction order can be determined graphically. If the natural log of concentration versus time produces a straight line, the reactant is first order. If the reciprocal of concentration versus time produces a straight line, the reaction is second order. If concentration versus time produces a straight line, the reaction is zeroth order. For the decomposition of ammonium nitrite, we might make 3 graphs. The concentration of the reactant versus time, 1 over the concentration of the reactant versus time, and the natural log of the reactant versus time. Since, in this case, the natural log graph is the straight line, that tells us that the reaction is first order with respect to that reactant. If the reciprocal of concentration versus time graph had been a straight line, then it would have been second order. If the concentration versus time graph had been a straight line, then it would have been zeroth order. This is a quick and easy way to determine the order of a reaction with respect to a reactant graphically. Number 5. Integrated rate laws are used to determine how the concentration of a reactant progresses. Each integrated rate law includes the rate constant, initial concentration, elapsed time, and concentration remaining after that elapsed time. The most common integrated rate laws we use are for first order and second order processes. Let's say we have this problem. The decomposition of dimethyl ether is a first order process. At 300 degrees Celsius, it has a concentration of 0.100 molar, but after 650 seconds, its concentration has dropped to 0.085 molar. What is the rate constant for the reaction at this temperature? Well, since it's first order, we're going to use the first order integrated rate law. And we just plug and chug into that equation. A sub t is the concentration after that elapsed time, so it's 0.085. A sub 0 is the initial concentration, which is 0.100 molar. K is the rate constant, which is what we're trying to calculate, and t is the elapsed time, which is 650 seconds. We can calculate these natural logs on our calculator and do some algebra. We find that the value for K, the rate constant, is 2.5 times 10 to the negative 4th reciprocal seconds. An integrated rate law has 4 functions: elapsed time, rate constant, initial concentration, and final concentration. As long as we know any 3 of those, we can calculate the 4th. Number 6. In order for 2 molecules to react, they have to collide with sufficient energy and in the correct orientation. Let's say we have 2 molecules of hydrogen and chlorine. In order to react, they have to collide quickly and with enough energy so that the collision can be successful and lead to a reaction. If the molecules are moving too slowly, they won't have sufficient energy to cause a successful collision. Even if the molecules are moving fast enough, if they collide in the wrong orientation, the collision will not be successful. This is kind of like taking a key and placing it into a lock. The key has to go into the lock in just the right orientation, otherwise the lock does not open. Number 7. A Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution curve represents the proportion of particles that have different speeds. As the temperature of a sample increases, a larger proportion of its particles will have a higher speed. In this Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, we see 4 different curves. Each curve represents the same sample of gas. It just shows the distribution of molecular speeds at those different temperatures. Notice that at all temperatures, whether it's very low like 100 kelvins or a very high temperature like 1000 kelvins, there are always some molecules moving very slowly. It's just that at higher temperatures, a greater fraction of the molecules are moving faster. And since they're moving faster, they collide with more force. This is why raising the temperature of a reaction vessel is so effective at increasing the rate of a reaction. Number 8. A reaction energy profile shows how the energy of the particles in a reaction change as the reaction proceeds. Here's a typical reaction energy profile for an exothermic process. Notice that the energy at the beginning of the reaction represents the reactants. Likewise, on the right side, we see the energy of products. This peak in the middle represents the energy of the transition state. It's a high energy activated complex that only exists for a very brief moment. The activation energy is the distance from the beginning of the reaction up to that peak. The activation energy, often abbreviated E sub A, represents the amount of energy it takes to get a reaction started. The change in enthalpy, abbreviated delta H, represents the difference between the beginning energy and the ending energy. Since this particular reaction has a net loss of energy, we say the reaction is exothermic. Energy is literally exiting the system. If this were an endothermic reaction where energy is entering the system, the profile would look more like this. If we add a catalyst, the reaction might look more like this. Adding a catalyst causes the energy of the transition state to decrease, and it causes the activation energy to decrease. But notice that the delta H, the reactant energy, and the product energy all stay the same, even after a catalyst is added. Number 9. A reaction mechanism can have multiple steps, and often they include reaction intermediates or catalysts that don't appear in the overall balanced equation. Most reactions take place in several steps. For example, this reaction has two individual steps that add up to the overall balanced equation. A reaction intermediate is a substance that's produced in an early step of a mechanism that ends up getting used up in a later step. In this mechanism, the intermediate is the OI negative ion. Notice that it's produced in step 1, but it's consumed in step 2. The reaction intermediate does not appear in the overall balanced equation. A catalyst is a substance that's present at both the beginning and the end of the mechanism, and it speeds up a reaction by providing a lower energy pathway, like we saw in the previous energy profile. In this case, the catalyst is the ion of I negative because it's present at the beginning and it's present at the end. Notice that the iodide ion does participate in the reaction mechanism, but since it's regenerated again at the end of the reaction, we can say that the catalyst is not actually consumed over the course of the reaction. Number 10. In a reaction mechanism, the slow step determines the rate of the reaction, and the rate law for the slow step is the rate law for the overall chemical reaction. If we have a reaction mechanism like this, and we're told what the slow step is, we can determine the rate law of the overall reaction. The rate law is written as rate equals K times the concentrations of the reactants for that slow step. In this case, that would be rate equals K times NO2 times NO2. We can simplify this as rate equals K times NO2 quantity squared. We can add the steps and find the overall balanced equation. We cancel out the reaction intermediate, NO3, and we cancel out NO2 and find that this is the overall balanced equation. Sometimes reaction energy profiles show multiple steps. This reaction energy profile has three steps, and each step has its own activation energy. Since the third step seems to have the highest activation energy, we can conclude that it would be the slowest step in the mechanism. Since the second step seems to have the lowest activation energy, we can say that step 2 would be the fastest step in the mechanism. And that's it. Those are the 10 things you've got to know from Unit 5. Remember that this isn't everything in Unit 5, but these are the 10 biggest ideas. Remember that if you're looking for even more review and practice, the ultimate review packet for AP Chemistry has everything you need to succeed in AP Chem. So go check it out over at ultimatereviewpacket.com. Hey, thanks for watching. Thanks even more for subscribing, and I'll see you soon.